Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you tonight that we can be here, and we thank you that you always hear our prayers, and you're a compassionate and loving Heavenly Father, and nothing concerns us that has already gone before your throne. Your Son is interceding, your Holy Spirit is working, and we pray for all these situations. Some are dealing with loss and death and tragedy. Others are in the interim of medical procedures. Others are traveling, and there's just a lot, Lord. We pray that your Holy Spirit would comfort hearts that are going through sorrow. Lift up those that will be counselors, and help most of all your word and the penetrating power of your Spirit to meet each and every individual need. We know you will. And speak to us tonight as we learn through your scriptures, and we are thankful most of all that we belong to you. You're the shepherd, and we are your sheep, and you carry us in your arms, and we thank you for that. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, we got a good group tonight. We're going to return back to Revelation chapter 13. And I'm going to, if you weren't here last week, you just need to get the outline. I'm going to just breeze through it because we have too much further to carry us through. This is probably, by the way, tonight, the most talked about aspect of Revelation. This is the movie-making deal, comes to this chapter in Revelation. So if you're new, this is the... For many people, this is the pinpoint, even what the world, when they think about Revelation, they think about this chapter and what is mentioned in this chapter. For instance, we've already learned about the sealing of the 144,000, the seal of God on his own. Well, we come to who is the Antichrist and what is the mark of the beast? What is the implications of that mark? And furthermore, what is going to be the result of a world dictator, a world religion? So these are the things that Armageddon, the end of time. This is the chapter that jumps right into that, so we're going to jump back in. If you do have your outline from last week, if you were with us, if you weren't, I will give you some highlights, all right? We learned last week, all right, about two beasts. A wild beast, the first one comes out of the sea. That is the Antichrist. He is the final world dictator. You can correctly call him the false Messiah. All right, we're going to learn about a second wild beast that comes out of the earth. That's the false prophet. They work together. It is the unholy trinity of Satan, the Antichrist, and the false prophet. I said last week you cannot separate a king from a kingdom. Antichrist, and John mentioned him in his epistles, he's against Christ, he's against the deity of Christ, but he also tries to imitate Christ. All right? We're going to go back to Daniel in a few moments, and we notice, if you notice here now in chapter 13, and I'm reading verse 2, and I saw a beast coming up out of the sea having 10 horns and 7 heads, and on his horns were 10 diadems, and on his heads were blasphemous names. Now, that's keep reading verse 2. And the beast which I saw was like a leopard, his feet were like those of a bear, his mouth like the mouth of a lion. And the dragon, which is Satan, gave him his power and his throne and his great authority. I said before, two books you really need to concentrate on or get a commentary on is the book of Daniel and the book of Zechariah. They talk immensely about what John is talking about. When Daniel talked about it, it was prophecy. By John's time, it's all fulfilled, all right? So if you're on your outline from last week, I'm moving down to the bottom of page 1. You can get the outline for me if you weren't here. The 7 heads, I just read, are 7 kings. All right? So Satan is the one that energizes them. This beast is a composite beast. That's number 1 under letter C from last week. He combines the characteristics of all the other beasts. All right? The panther or the leopard, that represents Greece. The bear, that represents Persia. And the mouth of the lion, that represents Babylon. In fact, it was really in the reverse order. Babylon came first. Conquered by Persia. Persia was conquered by Greece. And then you had the Roman Empire that was already starting to crumble, even in John's day. Okay? On to page 2 of your outline from last week. All right? So I'm just going to skip down to, well, I'll mention the great delusion, if you remember when we wrote that in, is that it will appear that the Antichrist is slain, and then it appears he's brought back to life by Satan. Satan can't bring life. He's only a death dealer. Only Christ can do that. So I agree with McGee. It's a fake, false resurrection, but it is a great delusion. so that people believe that lie, and he sets himself up to be God. All authority will be given to him. Now I'm coming down to the bottom of page one, all right? So this is the conditions in the last 3.5 years of the Great Tribulation. I'm on Roman numeral, I think it's 7 there. So we're learning now, we're going to learn about the second beast out of the earth. Letter A under Roman numeral 7 from last week's outline. This is the religious leader, all right? The beast imitates Christ. He poses like him. He's against him, but he imitates him, you see. He has 2 horns like a lamb, but he speaks like a dragon. I'm gonna fill in the outline and then flesh it out, including the second one tonight. So if you missed it, number 2 under letter C, he has what? Remember, delegated authority from the first beast, but he also has the same powers. The second beast will exalt the first beast to the place of worship. All right? Both are fake healers and miracle workers. All right? And we're going to talk in detail about letter C, the worker of signs and miracles. Okay? And we're going to talk about the image of the beast. Let's move on to your outline number 2. Some of you like me to fill it in, and then we'll flesh it out. So I'll do that for you tonight. On the second outline, which you should all have now, all right, we're talking about the first beast and the second beast. They are natural, but they exhibit seemingly supernatural powers. In fact, what Carney put at the top of his outline from previously summarizes the whole thing. I said last week, that's the big idea. That is the big idea of this chapter for sure. All right, now we're learning here that all of the earth dwellers are going to be deceived, that is, not under, except the saved, and they will worship this first one whose fatal wound apparently was healed. Both are fake healers and miracle workers. Now here's what you're to write in. So an image we're going to talk about, that's the icon made of the beast. The false prophet is a worker of, write in, signs and miracles. All right? The false prophet is a worker of signs and miracles. He imitates Elijah by bringing down, what did Elijah bring down? Fire from heaven. He imitates that. It's always imitation here. He's a combination of Jannes and Jambres, what they did by their counterfeit miracles in Egypt with their snake duplication. Remember that? So they had satanic, magical, we can call it that, magician power. God allowed it. So this big production is going to be this image. What exactly is this image that is erected? And it will emphasize that here's the one that was wounded to death and he's brought back to life. All right? Right in now, evidently, this image will be placed in the temple in where? Jerusalem, right? This must be what Jesus had in mind with the abomination of desolation. All right? That is the ultimate fulfillment of it. We're going to come back to Daniel, but let's move back down now so we can fill in. So we're going to learn, I'm going to read these verses now, to give breath to the beast is something that has not been done to an image before. All the prophets said idols are dumb, they cannot hear, they cannot speak. So this will, as McGee says, they'll probably call on all the scientists in the world to look over this, because this image will speak. This is a miracle, right in, they cannot explain. And we're going to learn you must have a what? Mark to do business. We're not necessarily out of sync with that, because when COVID went on, to buy or sell, what did you have to wear?
A mask.
Or you couldn't come in, right? So we get the little bit of that idea, right? So in John's day, soldiers were branded by their commanders, right in. Slaves were branded by their who? Masters or owners, either one. Those who worshipped in temples were branded by their god, little g, or their goddess that they served. All right? So that's enough for now. We'll come back to the outline. Now I want to read here. I want to read on. And let's begin now at verse 11. I'm going to read through the end of the chapter. You follow along. And I saw another beast coming up out of the earth. And he had 2 horns like a lamb, but he spoke as a dragon. He exercises all the authority of the first beast in his presence. And he makes the earth and those who dwell in it to worship the first beast whose fatal wound was healed. And he performs great signs, so that even makes fire come down from heaven to the earth in the presence of men. And he deceives those who dwell on the earth because of the signs which was given to him to perform in the presence of the beast, telling those who dwell on the earth to make an image of the beast who had the wound of the sword, and he comes to life. And there was given to him to give breath to the image of the beast, that the image of the beast might even speak and cause as many who do not worship the image of the beast to be killed. And he causes all, the small and the great, and the rich and the poor, and the free men and the slaves, to be given a mark on their right hand or on their forehead, so that no one should be able to buy or sell except the one who has the mark, the name of the beast, or the number of his name. Here is wisdom. Let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for the number is that of a man, and his number is 666. All right, now I've given you the outline. I want to flesh this out just a little bit. And by the way, going back, just if you weren't here last week, a couple of review points from the beginning of chapter 13, all right? So, you know, we're dealing here with the enemy of God, the devil. So he said he's not a life giver, he's a death dealer. So he uses imitation. He's always trying to imitate what the true creator does. I read this. You know, we learned already about the false, great white horse rider coming in to bring peace, and that's not Christ. Who is it? The Antichrist, right? I have read that there's been over, in human history, over 15,000 wars, and since that there's been a few since. 15,000 wars, 8,000 peace treaties signed. Man has only enjoyed 200 to 300 years of peace. Can you imagine that? Only 200 or 300. In the Great Tribulation, they're going to deify a new Caesar. He will be the ultimate president, the silver-tongued prime minister, the great humanitarian, promising peace, prosperity, and plenty. He will make himself God. Now, if you look with me at verse 2, he is going to be a characteristic of all those former empires. For example, he will be as the great dictator Nebuchadnezzar was. He is just a type. This will be the ultimate authoritarian. He will be the dictator of the world, like Nebuchadnezzar was in Babylon. He, like Persia, will have all the wealth. Persia was known for its wealth and its splendor and its empire. All the wealth and all the economy will be controlled by him. Like Greece, which Alexander the Great conquered everything in its path, and I was reading about him and studying before I came over, he conquered everything in his path but Jerusalem. That's out of Zechariah. He conquered everything, and he died the same age of Christ, as the same age as Christ, 33, but Alexander died a drunk. But his whole empire, conquer, and he did that. And so the Greece Empire, he will be the great military leader like Alexander was. And Greece was also known for its science and its literature and its arts. What's the New Testament written in? What? Greek, right? But science. He will be the one that proclaims evolution. And science is little g-god, as if to personify science, all right? He'll have all the characteristics of the Roman Empire. Many think it will be the Roman Empire reunited. But anyway, that's what the Antichrist will be. He will make himself God, all right? All authority will be given to him by Satan. And this will be his supreme moment, that is, for Satan to want to be worshipped. So the first beast comes out of the sea. The second beast comes out of the earth. The first one is the political leader, the world dictator. The second one, the false prophet, is the religious leader. They work together. They work in sync. And as somebody said, what Christ did as one, it took Satan with two to do that, or at least to imitate that. So the second beast that we're learning about is the epitome of all of the former empires, all right? So he has delegated authority. I'm reading 2 Thessalonians just as a review. Let no one deceive you, for unless the apostasy, that is the great falling away, comes first and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above every so-called God or object of worship, so that he takes his seat in the temple of God, displaying himself as to be God. So the second beast, get this now, is going to exalt the first beast. You must worship him. Like Nebuchadnezzar made that 90-foot tall statue and said, what? You got to bow before that statue or what? Die, right? So anyway, let's go back to your outline, and I want to look at a few of the Daniel ones here just for a moment. So let's go to those. Take your Bible. I do want you to turn to it and look, all right? Just a couple. You'll find these, I hope, fascinating. Go back to Daniel, major prophet, chapter 9 now, and verse 27 of Daniel. All right? And here's what is talked about here. By the way, I don't have time to get into verse 26, but remember, it's important you understand terms. When you see week in Daniel, it's talking about 7 years. So take a study on your own and study verse 26 about the Messiah being cut off. Time will not permit me tonight to get into that. But the follow-up of that is verse 27 of Daniel chapter 9. And he, that is the false, that is the Antichrist, will make a firm covenant with the many for 1 week, which is what? 7 years. But in the middle of that 7 years, he'll put a stop to sacrifice and grain offering. As I said before, I got a whole message on that. He will allow the Jews to reinstitute that. But the question is, are these the Jews trying to look for the true Messiah to come? Or is it the deluded ones? And then when he presents himself with all these miracles, he's the political Messiah we've been looking for. That's probably the idea there. But anyway, at any rate, whoever he's talking about with the Jews there, he takes that back in the middle and he makes desolate, that is, the temple, or that is the treaty that he made with them, until a complete destruction, one that is decreed. Now, I want you to go over to chapter 11. You will find this, I hope, fascinating. Daniel chapter 11. Now, notice verse 31. All right, Daniel chapter 11. And here we are in verse 31. I'm reading, same thought here. And forces from him will arise, desecrate the sanctuary, and do away with the regular sacrifice, and they will set up the abomination of desolation. That's what Jesus had in mind. Now, I'm going to get into a history aspect for a moment. Antiochus Epiphanes, in the silent years between Malachi and Matthew, he was one that desecrated the temple. So there's always a partial fulfillment, but the ultimate fulfillment is the Antichrist. All right? Now, let's go back to verse 37. A lot of people have speculated about this verse. So let's look, same chapter, verse 37. You might find this interesting. And I'm reading now, and I think the New American Standard gives the best translation of this verse. I'm reading verse 37. And he, that is the Antichrist, will show no regard for the gods. The word in the Hebrew is Elohim. So some have said that he will be a Jewish. The Antichrist will be Jewish because he will show no regard for the God of what? His fathers. On the other hand, Elohim is plural. It can be gods. And so some have said, no, he's got to be a Gentile because this is the fulfillment, ultimate fulfillment of the times of the Gentiles when they desecrate Jerusalem. You take your pick. I'm not going to say one way or the other. You got scholars that say he has to be a Jew, and others that say, no, the Antichrist will be a Gentile. All right? Here's the next part. Interesting. People have asked me about this. He will show no regard for the gods of his fathers or for the desire of women. In other words, he will probably be homosexual. And that's the idea of that verse. That wouldn't surprise me, because what is pushed today? Is that not pushed today? Yes. So that's that. People have asked me about that verse, but read on. All right? For any god, for he will magnify himself above all. So that's a fascinating verse, is it not? All right. Now, chapter 12 of Daniel, we're going back to Revelation. Chapter 12, verse 11, and from the time that the regular sacrifice is abolished and the abomination of desolation is set up, there will be 1,290 days. Remember before we said 1,260 days, or that means the last 3.5 years. So there's a little bit of carryover. I don't have time to get into it, but there's a transition between when he's done away with and Christ sets up his kingdom. And that's why it says in verse 12, blessed is he who keeps waiting and attains to 1,335 days. So I'll talk about that a little bit later on. It's just a brief transition, if you will. Let's go back to Revelation now and study again what we're talking about here now with the second beast. All right? So let's go back and I am going to quote largely tonight verbatim Fenton Ward in his book, God versus Government. I know at least one in here two that have that book. Because when we get to these views, his view is my view, okay? And I'm not saying it's the view, all right? But I think when we look at these things, particularly what's the mark, what's the image, what's the implications, I think it's very important. I want you to notice again verse 11 of chapter 13. This probably is the NIV. I've got several translations going. I saw another beast coming up out of the, he says land, I say earth. And he had two horns like a lamb, but he spoke like a dragon. I'm going to quote Fenton now. He says this, here we have an additional creature. This is the false Messiah, the Antichrist, the government's mouth and leader. He presents himself as a prophet who's Israel's Messiah, but he speaks as Satan's messenger. That's the point of the lamb, but he speaks like a dragon, all right? So he says, and it's very possible, this is out of the land of Israel. So his view is that he's Jewish, but that doesn't mean all the Jews accept him as the Messiah. Remember the what? 144,000 sealed, right? So in the story of Israel in chapter 12, we find that many, remember last week, that left out in the wilderness, don't forget that one branch of the olive tree is what? Jewish. Now get this, and this is his thought, and I think it's very possible. Rabbonic Judaism will initially accept him as the Messiah because they are looking for what? A political leader. What were they looking for in the first century? A political leader. All right? He says Islam will probably accept him as the 12th Imam, the ultimate prophet in their progression of prophets. Islam has a respect for Jesus because he's portrayed as a prophet, but they're looking for the one that is the greatest of all. All right? And somebody said, was talking to me, well, what about China? They're atheists. But again, all the nations are going to look for somebody that's going to be what? The great humanitarian leader to bring them all together, you see. I think this is fascinating. I'm quoting him again. Those of institutional Christianity who are biblically ignorant will accept him as a modern Jesus. Thank God. I know it's not your group, but there are that sit in pews that have no idea what's in store for them. What will he be like? He'll be very charismatic, very appealing. Since he sounds like a dragon, his message will be very humanistic, stressing the brotherhood of man and rejecting man's lost spiritual status. He will preach a message of human possibilities and limitless potential, limitless to the point there's no need for any outside God. Here is the little horn. When you see the little horn of Daniel, this is what concerned him. This is the Antichrist. And the major characteristic that Daniel noticed is that he has a mouth that speaks boastfully. When God's messenger explained the dream to Daniel, he talked about the fact that this little horn would subdue three kings. Remember, I talked about that last week. And in his mouth would speak against the Most High. John gives us further thoughts. Now read on again, verses 12 to 14. I'm reading it again. He exercised the authority of the first beast. And he makes the earth and those dwelling in it to worship the first beast, of which was the healing of the stroke of death. And he does great signs so as to make fire fall out of heaven onto the earth before men. And he deceives those dwelling on the earth because of the signs which he was empowered to do in behalf of the beast. So I'm reading again. It is the sea beast's mouth, the false Messiah. He operates full authority with global government. In other words, we have one world government, one world religion. This is what will be happening here. All right. Part of his slickness stems from his capacity to do seemingly by the miraculous, by Satan's power. He claims he can outdo Jesus. So he eliminates all competing beliefs. Now, I just want to give a historical aspect for a moment. If you read on your own, Daniel chapter 8, using the same analogy of the horn as a ruler, he speaks of a horn that springs from Alexander the Great's empire. And Daniel's vision, in the third year of Belshazzar, Daniel is given the destiny of Israel from the Persian conquest of Babylon until the end. Now, just listen on. All right, if you're not into history, this is fulfilled. All right, when you track Israel's history, which foretold of this Maccabean revolt, so you have Malachi's the end of Revelation, right? I mean, the end of the Old Testament. And here's Matthew. What's that 400 years? We call it what? The silent years, all right? In that time, there was this Syrian Greco king called Antiochus Epiphanes, and there was several under his name, and he desecrated the temple. He went in and he spewed pig's blood all over the holy objects. And by the way, many of the Jews, many of the Jews didn't want to die, or some of them, so they went along with them. Remember that when we come to the mark. Many of the Jews, some of them anyway, said, I don't want to die. So they actually abated and helped Antiochus in killing the Jews and desecrating the temple. So part of that prophecy, that's a local partial fulfillment. Often the prophets had partial fulfillment in something, But the ultimate fulfillment is in the future. All right, so part of that is that Antiochus Epiphanes, and he did that sacrilege of the temple. All right, so when and the disciples, remember when Matthew, well, what's going to be the end? When are you coming? What's the end of the age? Remember they asked that question? And the Mount of Olives. And so Jesus said, when you see the abomination that causes desolation, in other words, it's the future when the Antichrist comes. So Antiochus was a partial fulfillment of that. The ultimate fulfillment is when the Antichrist comes to rule. All right? So anyway, I wanted to make that point known. Now, going down now, so let's talk about this image. I'm reading on again, and let's read the verse here now that talks about this image, verses 14 and 15. He ordered those dwelling on the earth, it would be called in the original, the earth dwellers, to make an image of the beast that was struck by the sword and lived. And it was given to him to give breath to the image of the beast in order that the image of the beast might speak and make those who refuse to worship the image of the beast to be killed. Now, Fenton says, we need to decide which of these two beasts this image or statue or icon represents, all right? So it is a representation of the Antichrist, all right? The false prophet sets this up so everybody worships the first one. They're in sync together, all right? Now, I'm quoting him here. He says, 50 years ago, it was assumed that the actions of this image could be by direct demonic power. Today, seeing a robot move and speak to us and answer questions and give directions, it's merely a robot with a phone, according to him. This statue or this image has the ability to spot non-worshippers and turn them over to the government for re-education or elimination. All right? Now, I've speculated, and maybe you have speculated, what is this image? I'll never forget when I was in high school, and at the time I was wrestling a little bit with evolution. I went to my senior pastor, and I never forget, we sat down in the front row after Wednesday night service, all things, and he said his idea of what the image might be is actually, because remember, the beast really in the Greek or in the original means it's a wild, ferocious animal. His idea was they're going to set up a gorilla, whether he's locked up or not, and King Kong is going to speak. And then they're going to say, you see, evolution's true. All that's in the Bible, it's out, it's false, it's a lie. Look, we've made the animals speak. And the Antichrist is going to say, I'm the ultimate humanitarian. We're the ultimate of evolution's utopia. I always thought that was a fascinating possibility. Other people in the past have said, well, it's going to be a gigantic computer. But today we have computers at our fingertips, right? So that looks a bit antiquated. But maybe not when you think about something else, all right? But I've thought about this. This is my possibility with it, all right? And if any of you have ever been to Disneyland or Disney World and see the animatronics that go on there, I was always fascinated by that. In fact, I wrote a paper about great moments with Mr. Lincoln in Disneyland before I even got there. They published it in a magazine before I even went there. I was just so interested in that. But when my dad and I were visiting some friends out in California years ago, they were only about 25 minutes from Disneyland, so we went on a Monday. By the way, if you ever go to anything in California, don't go in September because they close down everything in September. I mean, it's just like refurbishing everything. That was about half the park was closed. But we went to Great Moments with Mr. Lincoln, and it wasn't really popular. There wasn't actually a lot of people in the park today, but I had my camera up there. I was ready to go, and it was, to this day, it's the most sophisticated robotic. I mean, it can sigh, it can breathe. It looks real, right? And this is just a computerized robot. I mean, it's Westworld, right? This is my idea that it will be something like that, so human and lifelike, you will not be able to tell the difference between that and the Antichrist. I mean, he can point out false worshipers. This is not just something that can do a few motions and computerize. This is fascinating. The other idea, if you think, and this maybe is the more horrific, and maybe the more the strongest possibility, if it is a statue or an idol, and then it actually speaks, And that's maybe the best thing of all, right? We don't know, but it is something that has never been done before. And think about robotics and medicine and on I could go. What will this image be? But it will be allowed to speak and command and eliminate unbelievers. Just like in Nebuchadnezzar's day, that great statue didn't speak, right? But if you didn't bow down to it, you were out, right? So, and if you didn't bow down to the Caesars in the first century, you could be eliminated as well. So there are a lot of possibilities there, but I'm reading on now, so that's what was going on with his image, all right? Now I'm going to back to Fenton because I think I'm going to further on because his thoughts are really my thoughts. So anyway, now we're reading verses 16 to 18. Again, I'm just reviewing that. We already read it. So everyone, it doesn't matter what class of people you are, you have to receive a mark. So what is this mark? What is the implications of that? I'm quoting him. No one will escape the demand to comply with the established monetary system. If you buy or sell, it must be within this system because this will be the only medium of exchange. The only escape will be to barter or scavenge or get a miracle from God. Vast pages have been written about the mark of the beast. And he says, the great bulk which fails to satisfy, and I agree. Many of those who have been who see the Antichrist have been Roman emperors. I could name Gesenaric and others, Pope Benedict, Paul IV, Mohammed. Some have actually said, oh, it's Martin Luther. Did you know he actually went against the Jews? So some say it was Martin Luther, if you're a historian. As others have said, Napoleon, Hitler, on and on it goes. And you can tag and get their number calculated. Generally, if you use Hebrew, Greek, or Latin, or numerical equivalents, and you attach the name, the letter of those names, sometimes it comes out to those numbers, all right? And in the historian view, in later centuries, most held that the two beasts are the Roman Catholic Church and its papal head. In fact, Luther, who was by some was the beast, he said, no, that was his view, that the two beasts was the Roman Catholic Church and the papal head, all right? Those who saw this book fulfilled in the first century said, Nero, he was the Antichrist. And you get Nero to equate 666 if you translate it into Hebrew and slightly vary the spelling of his name. And in the Greek, it's actually 600 plus 60 plus 6. That's the literal way to read it, not just 666. 600 plus 60 plus 6, if you break it down. All right? Perhaps the most important thing to realize in this system, or we think about 7 representing what? Completion, right? Really, technically, completion. All right? Man is incomplete. So the incompletion would be, in a sense, that man fell from his perfect state. So 6 is fitting for mankind, being the little model of God, but certainly less than God. It seems more profitable than counting the numerical content of everybody's name. If this gives meaning, we have the Trinity of man in 666, basically replacing the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit with organized self-rule, just like they tried to do at the Tower of Babel, right? We're going to overthrow God, and we are going to rule. And that's what is going to go on here. On a practical note, I'm reading him again, commitment to the false Messiah will be required to take part in the economic process of that time. Those who are committed to Jesus as the true Messiah and reject the Antichrist will have to survive outside this economic world system. Their lifestyle will be akin to today's homeless. Depending on charity or scavenging, God might feed them like ravens, by ravens like he did Elijah. Nothing is beyond God. Now, I'm reading the bottom of your outline now, so if you want to go down to the bottom of the outline on your second outline, make sure I'm the right one here. All right. Yeah, I'm at the bottom of page 1. All right, so government safety programs will be restricted to those who commit to the global government as their object of adoration. Lack of provision won't be seen. Hey, this is unfair. No, it's available to everyone. You just have to accept the system and its mandates. Most likely, this absolute control of exchange will gradually come into being. It will probably start out shortly after the beginning of the false Messiah's rule in a dual system, but then it will take over. Now stop and think about this today. I agree with him. We are already moving at breakneck speed toward the mechanics of such a system. Cash transactions today are almost non-existent, with coinage being seen as what? A nuisance. Coins are no longer made of precious metal. They have no barter value. The day will shortly come when the only proof of assets will exist in a cloud server. No money will be in one's personal possession. All transactions will be by electronic transfer of an accounting function where no actual money is involved. Again, the day will come when whoever controls the cloud controls the world. Are we starting to move toward that today? What then will be the actual mark? I take it literally that it will be on the forehead or the hand, and I take the number, I mean, the most obvious thing is everybody had the same number, then you can identify who has it, who doesn't. Again, unless John tells us otherwise, but let's consider something else. All right, what will then be the actual mark of the false Messiah? I'm quoting Mr. Ward. It will be your account number, whether on a piece of plastic or on a biometric insert beneath your skin. As to its position on the hand or forehead, that's maybe symbolic, though presenting your hand as to, you know, you pay for something with your hand or like your cell phone. So that could be the situation. So some systems, even today, automatically can scan your forehead or will be for data. Most likely, it will be an actual personal identification that brings up your full database in a centralized system. All right. Even today, there are current cloud servers that have the ability to store computer data in a centralized storage facility. So I'll go back. Maybe that image might be some gigantic computer. Who knows? If that's the place where it's all stored, right? So you take your pick. But that is fascinating to me about that image. All right. So most likely, whether it's the actual number or something to identify you, if symbolic, the mark of the forehead will reveal that you are dedicated and supportive of the false Messiah and his rule. Hand is a reference to work or day-to-day functions, so that would be, you again would show a commitment to this system. Now I'm reading the outline. John gives us a picture of life under the Jewish false Messiah. But other views exist in the Jewish community. Not everyone, Jew or Gentile, follows this world prime minister. He doesn't fool every Jew. There are vast numbers of Jews committed to the Messiah. Remember, 144,000. Followers are not limited to Jews, but still, the false Messiah does not speak for all the descendants of God's original missionary band. The Lamb of God has thousands and thousands still standing with him. Now, I'm not done. There is a corollary, because not everything is in chronological order. So I do want to read chapter 14. There's plenty to cover next week with Pastor Carney. But the corollary, the explanation of verse 18 is in chapter 14, verses 9 to 11. So it's really incomplete if I don't give that. So let's read again verses 17 and 18 of chapter 13. So no one can buy or sell except he who has the mark and the name of the beast and the number of his name. Here's wisdom. Let him who has understanding calculate the number, for that number is that of a man, and the number is 666. Now the follow-up is verse 9 of chapter 14. Follow along. And another angel, a third one, followed them, saying with a loud voice, if anyone worships the beast and his image and receives him, notice this, carefully read that, all right? If anyone worships the beast and his image and receives a mark in his forehead or upon his hand, he will drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is mixed in full strength in the cup of his anger. And he will be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment goes up forever and ever, and they have no rest day and night, those who worship the beast and his image, whoever receives the mark of his name. Here is the perseverance of the saints who keep the commandments of God and their faith in Jesus. I mean, this is a terrifying passage to read, isn't it? Now, what does this mean? All right. So I want to go back. I really wholeheartedly take Fenton Ward's view, and that's why I wanted to share it with you. But I've said this carefully because I've studied. When I read his book, this is the chapter in his book that stood out to me, and this is the reason why tonight. All right. So I read verses 9 to 11. He says here, and by the way, the first angel, we're going to learn about next week, commands that everybody worship the true creator. The second angel says, humanly devised religion will fail. This third angel gives a warning of horrific, horrifying judgment for worshiping the Antichrist and his government. Now, I'm quoting him, and this is probably maybe what you've heard. The most common mental image of this, probably formed by Christian movies, depicting the Antichrist, is a much more shallow view than what is involved. Now, I'm reading here, and it's probably on your outline, so let's go to the outline now. All right? All right, here I'm quoting him again now. So, damnation does not come by physically bowing before an idol to keep from being killed, but by giving one's dependence and allegiance to anything less than God. So, let's fill in the outline here. All right, I'm on the part two. Page 2, under Revelation 14, 9 and 11, this is the corollary. Damnation does not come by physical, this is one view, but I think it's my view. Damnation does not come physically, but by bowing before an idol to keep from being killed, but by giving one's dependence, right in, and allegiance to anything less than God. Now keep reading, follow in and fill in. Government's allure as the supreme provider already exists, does it not? But our current leaders are in no way as charismatic as the coming false Messiah. Keep going. The standard view of this passage is that people will have to choose to not take this, what, mark, or face eternal damnation. That's the standard view, and I'm not against it if that's your view. That is the standard view, all right? The angel, though, lists two actions right in. Worshiping the false Messiah and receiving his mark. The angel lists two actions. This is the follow-up of chapter 13. Worshiping the false Messiah and receiving his mark. So again, most likely, one view, it is my view, the resultant damnation comes from the worship of this false God. I'll repeat it. Most likely, the resultant damnation comes from the worship of this false God with the, what, mark simply being a normal part of affirming that. Everybody with me on the outline? All right? Okay. We're on page 2 under Revelation 14. I'll repeat it. All right? One view at the top, by giving one's dependence and allegiance. All right? That's page 2. All right? Government's allure is the supreme provider. All right? The standard view is that people have to choose not to take this mark or face eternal damnation. The angel lists two actions, worshiping the false Messiah and receiving his mark. So the resultant damnation comes from the worship of this false God, with the mark simply being a normal part of affirming that. I must move on. So the sons of Israel were to take a mark of circumcision. This is Bible. That was a sign that God had given them the promised land. Other cultures circumcise and still do. Circumcision does not make you Jewish, but for Jews, being circumcised shows a normal identification of who you are. All right? I'm moving on. The text says that damnation comes from those who worship the beast or the false god, whichever one you want to prefer, and its image, whatever that is, and receives a mark. And as Pastor Carney rightly said on Sunday, we came into this world separated from God, right? If you don't accept Christ, we're cut off. Hell is just the end of the road we were born on, unless we what? Accept Jesus' rescue, his salvation. Even for Christians, as he said, you can still move one step away, right? All right, now let me go back, because I got to move for the sake of time, all right? I want to flesh out this corollary verses here, all right? So I gave you the thoughts there. So the angel lists two actions. To me, this is the key. Worshiping the false Messiah and receiving his mark. I'm quoting Fenton. Listen carefully, all right? Listen and think now. Does damnation result if for a lack of faith, one takes the mark to do business, but secretly doesn't really worship the beast? What if one really worships the beast, but for some reason doesn't have the mark? Are you damned if you only do one of the two? And if so, which one? Or is it either one? Or do you have to do both? Let's work through that. How damning is receiving the mark itself? What if someone who has trusted Christ for salvation is forcibly branded with the mark? Does that damn him? Surely not. For if it were so, that would negate the promise Jesus made when he said, "And I give to them eternal life, and they will by no means perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand." The verb translated as receive means to acquire something by choosing to do so. It's an active verb, not a passive verb. To receive the mark means to deliberately choose to take it. Here we get into the fog, and he uses the fog a lot because where he lived, and I lived for a year, every morning in the Monterey Bay would bring in fog and blanket everything. It would be till the midday that would clear up. But he talks about, here's where we get into the fog. What if a believer receives the mark just to buy food because his faith is too weak to risk salvation. And maybe in that day, the guy's trying to provide for his family and he's desperate and he might break into a store, right? To take the mark or whatever, to get food. So what if a believer receives the mark just to buy food because his faith is too weak to risk starvation? Yes, he did receive it as an entry into the system out of fear of starving. But in the sense of this, did he really receive it? If he really trusted Jesus as his Savior and then in weakness falsely made this commitment, where does he stand? Surely being marked against your will would not negate your salvation, but what about the weak Christian who makes a false pledge of allegiance to this false Messiah? Does that promise of Jesus, no one will snatch him out of my hand, still stand? Can the weak Christian, for current benefit, pry himself out of Jesus' hand? Surely the mark itself does not damn, but something else. Most likely, or more likely, the resultant damnation comes from the worship of this false god, with the mark simply being a normal part of affirming that, as I had you put in your outline. As I already talked about the sons of Israel taking the mark, and that was an identification. The text clearly says that damnation comes to those who, number one, worship the beast and its image, and number two, receive a mark. Worship seems the damning decision, with receiving this mark as the expectant follow-up, like baptism is for the Christian. If so, whether you are marked or not is not the damning factor, but who you worship in your heart. Thinking damnation comes by committing some evil act misses the truth. We are not damned by what we do, but we remain damned by what we don't do. As I said, we come into the world separated from God, and if we don't accept Christ, we remain cut off. Hell is just the end of the road we were born on unless we accept Jesus' rescue. In this coming world banking system, believers in Jesus will face a repetition of a problem for the early church martyrs. When faced with death or declaring Hail Caesar, which was the worship of who? The emperor. Many recanted their commitment to Christ. Afterward, the bishops were embroiled over their proper status of those who wanted to return to the church. Should they be allowed back into the fellowship, or should they be prevented from returning? Worse, were they still saved or not? Considering the propensity of born-again Christians today that still can live faithless, carnal lives, it seems that some, perhaps even many, will not have the faith to reject the only existent economic system. Perhaps worse, a high probability exists that many who have remained biblically ignorant will accept their body debit card and be oblivious to what they have done. What about the teenager who honestly trusted Christ for salvation, but then got too smart in college to follow him, and now just assumes this system of banking with its organic password seems the reasonable thing to do? What is his or her status in eternity? Your answer will depend on your view as to the eternal security of the believer. The easy out is to say this person was not really saved, but that's not the example given. The answer also seems to expect more from the saved than they have historically displayed. If you believe one can lose his salvation, then you would just assume that this act can make you unsaved, reversing the birth from above and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. If you carry logic to the conclusion you're saved by grace, not by works, lest any man should boast, you believe such a one is still heaven-bound, stupid as he has been. After all, if our actions have nothing to do with salvation, and we are saved by our trust in God's grace rather than our own righteousness, neither do acts undo our salvation. Security of the believer is not our subject, but it seems the mark itself is not a damning factor. Now that's my view, as it is with eternal security. But if you take the standard view, that's fine. I'm not here to debate about it. I'm really not. But as I've carefully studied the text, that's where I land with it. What about the worship? The ones that really worship the beast in its image. Those that do, they are in deep trouble. This implies a personal commitment of trust and adoration of the false Messiah and the government he leads. Again, though we've spent time on specific possibilities, the angel warns us that the natural result of this life commitment to the false Messiah brings an eternal death. The receiving of the mark seems to be what one who has so committed would naturally do. The phrase that John seems to summarize the characteristics of those who have absolutely no concern for the true God of all, rather than being a litmus test for eternal survival. However, the cowardly Christian who in his heart does not worship the beast but takes the mark to survive does not totally escape either. Read verses 11 and 12. And those worshiping the beast and its image have no rest day and night. And if anyone receives the mark of his name, here is the patience or the required endurance of the saints, those obedient to God and faithful to Jesus. The warning to the saints, the redeemed, is to exhibit endurance. If there wasn't a risk that saints might fail to endure out of weakness or stupidity or whatever, we wouldn't have been warned, right? On the way over, I heard a sermon by Chuck Swindoll. I know he's talking about Peter, the last days of, you know, the last hours of Christ. Remember, he said, I'll die for you. What did he do? He denied him. In fact, the second time he said, may a curse come down on me. I don't know the man. Did he deny him? Yes. Who reinstated him? Jesus. And Swindoll said, I'm glad the pages of history ended there, because if it had to record all of us and all the times we have failed the Lord, do you think we could be in the pages too? Absolutely. Absolutely. So Peter denied him and was reinstated. I'm coming to the conclusion here. So if there wasn't a risk, why would the angel exhibit that warning? But before the false worship and the taking of the mark is seen as a joint action, they're seen, as, in my estimation, as two separate things. The subject shifts from one's ultimate status to judgment here on earth. In the case here, suffering comes from those who do either. So therefore, whether you are a true worshiper of the false Messiah or a Christian of weak faith who takes the mark, both will suffer, even if you believe the one's eternally secure. Now, the follow-up is verse 13, all right? And I heard a voice out of heaven saying, right are the blessed that the dead in the Lord from their dying on. Yes, says the Spirit, blessed are they that have rest. The unbeliever has no rest. What we have done for the Lord, and we enter eternity, we're going to find rest. I think that's what Jesus had in mind when he said, come all ye that are heavy laden and burdened, and what? I'll give you rest. Rest. So again, as martyrs with all ages, not all Christians are weak and faithless. And I would say the majority are going to refuse to say, Hail Caesar, and will pay the ultimate price. And they will be included with vast numbers who have already, remember there's a great revival that goes on in the first part of it, remember that? Most of them will be killed. They're the ones seen in heaven. It will be a great revival and most of them will be eliminated, right? So this is the situation here with the rule of the false Messiah. And as we say, again, one of the spiritual gifts is martyrdom. Surely those who face that fate will be supernaturally strengthened and face their destiny in peace. I do want to close not on a negative note, but a positive one. I want you to go back to Psalm 27, all right? I want to close on a positive note, because this can leave us all in fear and trepidation if we just don't take in what God wants us to know. I read verses tonight that several of them, that He carries us in His arms. We are His lambs. Isn't that wonderful to know? Read Isaiah 40 tonight. He picks us up and He carries us close to His heart. That's a wonderful reassurance. Now, Psalm 27, you ever read this before? The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I dread? And he talks about all those that come. They can't do anything. David said, I want to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And we're going to be with him forever. So we are his lambs. We are in his arms. He has gone before us as our shepherd. He's behind us guarding the way. And he's with us. He never leaves us or forsakes us. The Holy Spirit's in you, Christ is in you, and you're going to be able to do what you could never do on your own. Isn't that wonderful to know? Because we are indwelt by God Himself. And so we can walk out of this world with a message to share, right? A lot of the world knows about that, the chapter we talked about tonight, but a lot of them have not received the salvation that they so desperately need, right? Amen. Let's stand together and I'll close tonight in prayer. Heavenly Father, We thank you that we have been saved, that you have fixed your attention upon us in eternity past, and you moved in our hearts to receive the message of salvation, and by the power of the Holy Spirit and the conviction at a point in time, we received you as Lord and Savior, and our destiny is forever changed. Lord, we thank you tonight that though we don't have everything completely explanatory, we do want to understand as much as we can your book and the final book of the Bible. Give us insight and understanding, and we thank you that we can continue to study it, and we thank you that you keep us forever in your arms and you're preparing that home for us in heaven. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Thank you for coming.